Thank you. You may be seated. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, if you have a copy of God's Word, would you turn there? 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Again, I want to thank many of you. Have been very encouraging. I've gotten texts and a few emails here and there. And I'm grateful because I preached the longest sermon in my entire 27 years of preaching the Word of God. I was an hour last week. And I say this honestly, and people are very kind. I worry about your time. I want to be a good steward of your time and not waste your time. And an hour is a long time to sit, though all of us can certainly sit for an hour and watch our favorite television show. It's a hard to listen, and I'm one of those people. I have a hard time sitting still in the meeting for an hour. Usually I got to get up and move about minute 26 or 7 maybe. And so I get that. I understand that. But I'm grateful. None of you complain. And I think I know why, because of the topic we covered, and I didn't even get to all of it last week. But I thought it was needed and necessary. And this topic, I promise you'll be no different. I'll be honest, these last three messages have been the most difficult to prepare. There have been roadblocks. I'll be honest with you, I finished all three of these messages on Sunday morning. And that's the truth. I'm being honest and transparent with you. These are challenging topics to try to read enough, to study enough, to pray enough, and say, God, I want your words for this body of believers. This subject is the most challenging. It can provide the most controversy, if we want to call that. The last ones were pretty much, we think, cut and dried. And I believe by the time we get through, I think that you will see maybe perhaps from a fresh perspective about maybe this is more cut and dried than what we think, maybe than what we imagine. And I'm asking God to speak into our lives this morning. And remember the backdrop, the backdrop we have behind this message is the idea of our calling to be pure and holy people. 1 Thessalonians 4:7, again, remember that theme verse. God has not called us for the purpose of impurity, but to live holy lives. It's not easy to do. It's not sometimes fun to do. It is challenging in this day and age to live such a way, to live a life of holiness. But nonetheless, I think that is what we're called to be. This morning, I want you to know and hear my heart on the front side before we dive into this topic. And I think it's my desire, and I think it's your desire too, that we want to be an example in every area of our Christian walk. That we would never cause anybody to stumble, to live convictionally in such a way that we would never damage our witness, our walk with the Lord. We all have that desire about not just this subject, but any subject. And I think this, let me say this too, I think the principles of this message will apply to really any principle that you want to talk about in our Christian lives. And I think all of us, at the bare bones of our walk, we want to point people to Jesus, right? Oh, good. Let's try that again. I'm just testing to see if you're awake and you failed, all right? Let's try that again. Our desire is to point people to Jesus, yes? Amen. Absolutely. That is our desire. We don't want to stamp, wave a white flag and say, hey, we want to point you to hell and to Satan if we can. That's our goal. We don't put that up in the sign, you know. We don't do that. Nor do we go to the opposite extreme. We don't put turn or burn. I've always thought about attempting to do that on the sign out there. But you don't want to do that either, right? We don't go to either extreme. But what do we want our lives to speak into the lives of other people about this issue? And it's my heart's desire to speak about this issue with compassion and yet conviction. I pray all these messages have been in that manner. I pray you've received them that way. But I want you to know in my heart that I'm convicted and have been convicted about this issue since I was a junior high student. And it's easy for me to preach about this issue, all right? Last week's is harder for me to preach about, okay? I'm being honest with you. This one's not as hard for me because it's one that is a core conviction. And last week's is a core conviction too. It's just not, well, this one's not one that I struggle with. So I want you to hear, if I present passionate to you, I want to be just as passionate about last week as I am this week, but I want to be just as compassionate, but yet just as convictional about this. I will argue and believe and stand on this conviction and argue against the liquor industry with every fiber of my being. And I'm going to tell you why that is in a moment, but I want to say it on the top line, and I want to come back and talk about why that is the case. Now, some would say, and I think it certainly is discussable, that the Bible teaches that there is moderation in drinking, that there's okay to drink, and that's hence my message, all S's. I don't know if you, I'm sure y'all pick up on all this, don't you? You all my alliterations, y'all catch that all the time, don't you? Good, thank you. Tony's nodding with me. It's got me. All right, so we've talked about the slippery slope. Today we're talking about this. You read, this is a pretty good title. I mean, I don't know if you caught it or not. sober, social, or smashed, right? There's our three options about drinking. What does the Bible speak about this? And I think the Bible speaks to these issues. But some would say it doesn't speak to condemning about drinking socially or to drinking in moderation. Josh Franklin said this statement, "Alcohol does not send a person to hell. It is not a top-tier doctrine for our faith and practice as believers, and I do not look down on those individuals who have taken an honest, unbiased look at the issues surrounding alcohol and hold a different view." I want you to know that is my heart as well. That we don't judge anybody. We don't speak in pride. I don't speak in pride. I don't speak in self-righteousness to you. But I do want to speak convictionally about what I believe is the principle taught here in Scripture. Some have talked about this, and there, you may have heard of the Reformed movement. There is a sweeping part in our convention that is this Reformation movement, if you will, about Reformed theology. It's called TULIP. It's the 5 points of Calvinism. A lot of younger students in seminaries today are being brought up in this fashion. I don't agree with all five of those points. I agree with a couple of them, but I don't agree with all five, I believe. But in this group called Young Restless Reformers, I think is the name of them, and I have a former student of mine, another former church that would find himself in this group. They're going to talk about Christian liberty. And if you talk about this issue, they're going to say, wait a minute, you're being legalistic. The Bible says, I'm free. Who is the Son has said it's free indeed. We're free. And I would agree with them 100%. We are free in Jesus. However, in that freedom comes, watch this, responsibility and accountability and being a witness and an example. I can remember 20 years ago, if I'd had this conversation with a bunch of students and I would say this statement, hey, listen, would you mind our next fellowship? We're going to go and we're going to all belly up to the bar and I'm going to come with you and I'm going to be your bartender. All right? Any problems with that? And of course, all my students would be like, oh, no, wait, you couldn't do that. I'm like, well, no, why not? What's the problem with that? I had that same conversation now, and over half or more would not see any issue with that whatsoever. But that's concerning to me as your pastor. I hope to God that you hold me to a higher standard than that. I hope you do. Now, does that mean that I can walk on water and I'm perfect? Absolutely not. Do I struggle with sin like you do? Absolutely. You know why I know that? Because I put my pants on one leg at a time, just like you did this morning. So what does it say here? And you be careful. What does Proverbs 20 verse 1 say? And I don't have these two scriptures up here. Just listen to me at these, and I'm going to jump to 1 Corinthians in a second. Proverbs 20 verse 1 says, "Wine is a mocker, strong drink a brawler, and however is intoxicated by it is no wise." The next one says this, Proverbs 23. "Who has woe? Who has sorrow? Who has contention? Who has complaining? Who has wounds without cause? Who has redness of eyes? Those who linger over wine, those who go to taste mixed wine. Look on wine when it is red, when it sparkles in the cup, when it goes down smoothly. At last it bites like a serpent and stings like a viper. Your eyes will see strange things and your mind will utter perverse things." Guarantee it, you will never read in the newspaper in my obituary, "Brad Eubank died because he was holding a snake." Never. You'll never read that. "Brad Eubank was holding a viper and it somehow miraculously bit him." Okay? If that ever happens, you will know one of two things has happened. I have been poisoned or I've had a brain hemorrhage and I am not thinking clearly, because when I see a snake, I believe to do one of two things, one of three things. My first instinct, and I may be considered a sissy, and that is fine. I have no problems with that. I will run. I believe to flee. Okay? I believe when Jesus condemns, God condemns snakes in the garden, I believe he condemned them. I'm going to stay far away from them. Or if I have a gun, I will shoot it. From time to time, we always think Satan's attacking us. From time to time, these snakes will come out of these woods over here and just kind of slither across and right across the church thing. And he's like, go get it. I'm like, I'm going to get it. I'm going to watch it go right on by. That's what I'm going to do. I'll get a hoe if I got to, and kill if it's going to attack my family. Otherwise, I'm going to leave that little sucker alone. He can climb on somewhere else. You'll never read that I got too close to a snake and it bit me. Now, some of you folks, you love snakes. God bless you for loving snakes. That's great. I love these people that are, you know, animal lovers. There are good snakes and bad snakes. There's only one kind of good snake, and that's a dead one. I'm sorry. That's just the way I feel. If you love snakes, bless you. I had church members in my last church. They raised snakes, and they raised mice to feed the snakes. He said, will you come for a visit? And I said, absolutely not. What if I need you? I'll meet you at the church. I'll meet you at the gas station, but I am not coming to your house. What if my snakes get out? I'll say, I'll pray for you. That's from a distance. That's all I'm going to do. What is my point here? The Bible says here that is like a viper. Sometimes those snakes are good to hold, but sometimes they can cause great problems. James Merritt, the pastor of Cross Point Church in Atlanta, Georgia, said, it is impossible to be bitten by a snake that you never play with. Adrian Rogers says this, alcohol, the pastor, former pastor of Bellevue Baptist Church, alcohol has brought this world unparalleled suffering. As a counselor, I know that alcohol will cause a man to lie to his mother, a man to beat his wife. It will cause a man to deprive his children. It will cause an otherwise virtuous woman to forget her marriage vows. It will turn obedient children into rebuke against their parents, against society, and against God. J.D. Greer, pastor in North Carolina, said this statement, we know statistically that 1 in 7 students who drink will become, in fact, an alcoholic. 1 in 7. He said this statement, I won't keep a dog in my house that will bite people only 1 out of 7 times that they entered my house. And I won't play around with a drink that has a solid chance of sabotaging and destroying my life or the life of someone I love. If 7 people follow my example and drink socially because I do, and 1 of them becomes an alcoholic, listen to this, God holds me responsible. Is that a chance I'm willing to take with my children or in those who look up to me? Every year, every single year, 1,700 students, college students, die from overdrinking. We're at spring break time. We will see many of those happen on the beaches of Florida and Alabama over these next several weeks. 1,700. Think about this for a moment. That's 4 jumbo jetliners packed with college students that would die. What would be the implication for an airline if they packed 4 jumbo jets and they died? Let me tell you what they would be. We saw 2 of those happen with Malaysia Airlines. One shot out of the sky. Another one disappeared randomly, and we've never found it yet. Malaysia Airlines went bankrupt. Yet we don't think about it that way. The dean of students at Duke University said that 1/3 of all, easily, maybe more, of all discipline-related issues in his office came through because of alcohol. Let's talk about the concerns. Let me read this scripture. Well, I'll tell you what, I'll come back to 1 Corinthians in a moment. I'll come back to it in a minute. Let's just jump ahead to the points quickly, if you will. Let's talk about the concerns. Let me quote some statistics to you very quickly, and they're going to set the stage for us. These are important. I'm not a statistics guy, although I am in some ways. These help open our eyes to see things we might not normally see. Alcohol companies spend close to $2 billion every year advertising in the U.S. Youth exposure rose 38% from 2001 to 2007. And to add to that, or one I found this morning, from 2001 to 2009, it increased, TV exposure increased by 71%. That's not even taking into account the internet or stuff that students read. By the time a typical teenager is 18 years old, he has seen 100,000 beer commercials. 100,000. You don't think that's true? I'll never forget. My son, was it Matthew or William? I said Matthew. Who was it? Matthew William. We went to Walmart. I think it's Matthew. We went to Walmart, and we all have NASCAR racing cars, right? We got into the Cars movie. I remember the Cars movie back on. So that's, our kids were little when that came out. And so we started watching real NASCAR. Everybody had to have a driver. So I am number 5. Yeah, number 5, because I was the oldest driver they could find at the time, which was, I think, Casey Kane, I think, was the time. He's the oldest guy, and he's not now. But anyway, and so Matthew's 88, and Rebecca was number 2, because that was her number in high school baseball. Well, if you know anything about NASCAR, Charlie Mack, NASCAR number 2, that's the Miller Lite car, all right? That's the Miller Lite beer car. So Matthew, they're in there one day, huge display. And he says, Mama, look, it's your favorite drink. Whoops. So don't think that they're not watching, because they are, the advertising. The median age, listen to this. This is statistically proven, folks. Median age at which children begin to drink alcohol right now is 13 years old. That's the median. Now let me help you know a little bit about the median. That means there's some that are older, watch this, and some that are what? Younger. 13. Statistics tell us that students try their first drink of alcohol, their first drug experience, and their first sexual experience happens at the average age of 12. Over 83% of adults who had their first drink of alcohol did so before the age of 21. 4 out of 10 students who picked up alcohol before 18 years old became alcoholics. 4 out of 10. 75 to 90% of high school seniors say they've drunk alcohol sometime in their lives. 4 million Americans under the age of 18 are alcoholics. 4 million. Rush, you can speak to this at your place, Pine Grove. That is a stunning 26% of underage drinkers compared to only 10% of adults. 67% of high school seniors that were graduating walk across our stage have used alcohol within the last month. 38% said they've had 5 or more drinks in a row, which is considered binge drinking, within the last 2 weeks. 6.1 million students were binge drinking in the past month, and 1.7 million did so at least 5 days a month. 36% of fourth graders, 36% of fourth graders, 9 and 10-year-olds, said they have been pressured by their peers to drink alcohol. 25% of all alcohol consumed in America is consumed by those under the legal drinking age of 21. Teen drinkers are seven times more likely to engage in premarital sex and a lot more other behaviors besides that. Youth who drink alcohol at any level are 7.5 times more likely to use an illicit drug and 50 more times, listen to me, 50 more times likely to use cocaine than a young person who never drinks alcohol. The number one killer of teenagers, you know what it is? Alcohol. Number one abused substance among teenagers? Alcohol. 2/3 of all school assault and date rapes among teens and college students involve alcohol. This year alone, teen alcohol will kill 4,700 teenagers this year. That's more than all the other illegal drug deaths combined. On average, this will wake you up, 2 in 3 people in their lifetime, 2 out of 3, all right? I don't know if we got a count yet. How many we got yet? Do we know yet? We counted? 270. Somebody tell me, what's 2/3 of 270 quickly? Yes, tell me what. Holy cow, that's amazing. Wyatt, stand up just a minute, son. Stand up just a minute. This boy is brilliant, by the way. Just took a math test. Where's your mom? Where's Jennifer? Or you tell me, Wyatt, what'd you just make? A first place in what? Some contest, right? Like all over the country. This is our next NASA scientist right here. We want you to find like the cure for cancer, Wyatt, so start working on that right now, okay? I don't know how that involves math, but I got a master's degree, and I couldn't have figured that out if it took me a year and a half. Thank you, Wyatt. 180. So congratulations, 180 of you, before you die, will be involved in an accident involving somebody that is drunk. 2/3. Every 53 minutes, somebody loses their life in a drunk driving accident, and every 2 minutes, somebody is injured in a drunk driving accident. That translates to 10 to 15,000 deaths annually. Car crashes are the leading cause of death for teenagers, and about 1/4 of those crashes involve an underage drinker. 1 in 3 American families suspect that 1 or more family members have a drinking problem. The economic cost of alcohol are estimated to be around $223 billion in 2006. The health-related costs are around $26 billion. Alcohol plays a significant role not only in the top leading cause of death, but the top 4 leading causes of death among teenagers or students aged 14 to 24. Does that shock you? Is that just like you're going, holy cow, but the beer industry and the alcohol industry would have you never to see these kind of statistics. What I wish they would do is when they put those awesome commercials up and these beautiful, handsome, gorgeous, skinny, hot-looking girls and guys dance on a beach and smile, they would put right behind that in every ad the warning, right? Warning, this is what could happen to you. This is what is happening in our country, but you don't ever see that. A picture flashed of a drunk driving accident. A picture of a family grieving because they lost a family member because I was intoxicated and killed their family member. You don't see that. You don't see one of the founding sons of Coors Light, who, by the way, a couple years ago, I think it's back in 2006 or 7, was arrested, who says, drink responsibly, was arrested for DWI. in the state of Colorado. Mr. Coors was his name. We know about blood alcohol content. Maybe you do or you don't, but blood alcohol content, if it's 0.08 in the state of Mississippi, you're considered legally drunk or higher. If you have a 0.01 to 0.05, the effect of alcohol does this. It brings to a greater loss of judgment and coordination. Your thinking is dulled, and it changes your mood and behavior. These are scientific facts. Someone who weighs 129 pounds or less, that would not be me, not even close. But if you weigh 129 pounds or less, listen to this, it takes less than one 12-ounce beer, less than 1 4-ounce of wine, or a quarter of an ounce of 80-proof liquor, and you will have between a 0.5 and a 0.08 blood alcohol content. You with me on that? Now, I'm not smart to know all that, but let me tell you what that produces. Walking, your speech, and your hand movements become clumsy. Blurred and split or tunnel vision may occur. And when you're at this level, your chances of an accident are increased 300%. Those are the stats. I gotta go quickly here. We're gonna have to blow through. And I'm gonna put all these notes on the website this time so you can read them. All right? The command all of us agree upon. Here it is, and I think nobody in the room would doubt this. Being drunk is wrong. Everybody's going, we got that one, preacher. We are with you on that one. That's no doubt. Ephesians 5:18 tells us, and do not get drunk with wine. All right? I'm not gonna spend any time there. There's a little controversy about that. If you got a problem with that one, then we're gonna have to have a different kind of conversation. All right? That one is crystal clear. The command all agree upon, being drunk is wrong. Secondly, or thirdly, the concept that has caused great confusion. Social drinking, or drinking in moderation, some say is even encouraged by Scripture. Are there places in the Bible where drinking wine is commended? And the answer is yes. Without question, but that begs another question about that alcohol and wine, and what exactly were they talking about? I've done extensive reading on both sides. I ordered books. I've got books this thick of scholars and people who've done research that are a whole heck of a lot smarter than me, which wouldn't take a whole lot, to study who studied back about these issues. Some love to talk about John chapter 2. You ever heard this statement? Jesus was the first bartender. That's been said a lot. What about that? What, is that true? We'll talk about that in just a moment. Let's talk about the commendation by our culture that should give us caution. The commendation by our culture that should give us caution. What do I mean by that? Here's what I mean. If our culture commends something, okay, we need to stop and take pause. Are you with me? If our culture says, yep, that is excellent, you ought to do that, we ought to stop and examine it. Now, does that mean that everything our culture commends is bad? Absolutely not. But if our culture goes along with something so gung-ho, they want everybody to go with them, then what should we do? If 50%, statistics say well over 50% of our culture are regular drinkers, 50%. I had to stop and think about it in my mind. Would we find our culture on this issue on the wide road or the narrow road? Over 50% would lead me to believe, I think, that we might find ourselves on the wide road and not the narrow road. I've asked people from time to time, maybe somebody's asked you this, why do you drink? Well, I've asked people before, why do you drink? And by the way, when I ask that question too, many times I've had that conversation, it's because I've seen Coors Light literally become the silver bullet, and I mean literally, because it's going so fast to hide from me as if I'm God or Jesus or something. I've seen it thrown over shoulders. I've seen it thrown in the back of pickup trucks. I've seen people jump on top of Walmart buggies. I mean, I've seen people it's like, oh my goodness gracious. Jump on the buggy, honey. It's the preacher, right? Look at his buggy. See what he's got. You know, it's this panic, right? So I ask me, why do you drink? Well, here's the things that I hear from time to time. Well, I enjoy it. It relaxes me, allows me to enjoy life a little bit more. It takes the edge off. I like the way, my favorite one, I like the way it tastes. Now, nothing wrong with that necessarily in of itself, but I would kindly object and offer something a little bit different. By the way, you also hear people say, well, we need to be a little more like Europe. We need to teach our kids how to drink early. You ever heard that said before? I've heard that a lot. Well, they know how to handle their alcohol. A nice Christian way to say this, statistically, bull. Well, how do you know? Well, statistics tell us Europe has the highest average drinker in America, in the world. Europe has them in some of the leading countries. And yet 10 to 14% of total deaths in Europe are alcohol related. In America, it's 2 to 5%. So somewhere the myth doesn't translate real well. Now, am I of the opinion that I need to hide my kids? And I'll be honest with you, my opinion since last week's message and preparing for it 2 weeks ago about trying to hide my kids from everything, I want to hide them and protect them as much as possible, which I do, and I have to do that to some extent. But what I'm finding more and more, you know, I have to do, I'm going to have to educate them better. I'm going to have to teach them how to deal with what they're being told. Are you with me? We used to be able to just protect our kids, and most of our kids we wouldn't think would be exposed to it. The certainty on the change of alcoholic content. Let me bring this through briefly. Three thoughts here. Number one, in biblical times, and even before and even after, there was intoxicating and non-intoxicating wines in biblical times. We're going to talk about wines in particular. The word for shikar, I think, is the word for strong drink. Most people that would say that you can't get drunk would say to drink strong drink would be wrong. We'll talk about why that is in a moment. But we're talking about wine in particular. That's one people love to talk about more than anything else. Well, I know I shouldn't drink, you know, hard liquor, but I can drink wine. There's a difference between those two. But I want you to know, in biblical times, there were some things about wine that were produced different than they are today. Now, you'll find some different scholars who would disagree about the content, how much difference there were, but every scholar that I read agreed there was a great difference between the alcoholic content of then and of today, in particular when you're talking about wine. The second statement, the wine of today is nowhere close and as the same to the alcoholic content as today's wine. Yale University study on alcoholism says that it was revealed the normal process of fermentation of called the fruit of the vine does not produce a drink with sufficient alcohol content to bring on drunkenness. In order for that to happen, there must be a mechanical interference. Now, I'm not a scientist here. Dr. Williams is, and he can really key you in on this. I don't know where Doc is. Somewhere over here. There he is, Doc. He knows all about this science stuff, all right, about the chemicals and all that stuff. I just have to quote smart people like him, okay? There has to be a chemical interference, such as an addition of pure alcohol or, by the way, ethanol. I found that really funny. Ethanol, right, Doc? Okay, now I know it's not the same kind, but what do we put in our cars? I'm right, ethanol. I feel so smart all of a sudden. That's really good. Now, granted, I'll give you. Somebody says if you see a stomach on Mountain Dew, it's not any prettier. I don't know. It may not be, and I drink one of those a day to keep the doctor away. But I, ethanol, do you realize what we're putting what we put in our bodies? We put in our cars. Just stop and think about that for a moment, all right? Ethanol. So we have to, something has to be added to it and has to be distilled. The Hebrews would have referred to our modern-day wine as strong, or beer as strong drink. Let me say clearly, Jesus was not, has not, never has been in the liquor business. And he is not a bartender. Never was, never will be. And let me talk about what I mean by that. Robert Stein, another New Testament scholar, talks about the wine of, boy, I mean, we could be here for days. There's so much here. Talking about the purification process and all that happens and how the water was good and bad and it was something that was drank. Here's what he says. Dr. Stein noted that one would have to drink 22 glasses of wine in order to consume the alcohol only found in 2 martinis today. There's a difference. There's a vast difference. Dr. Norman Geisler said this statement, Christians ought not drink wine, beer, or other alcoholic beverages, for they're actually considered strong drink, and those are forbidden in Scripture. Even ancient pagans did not drink wine of what some Christians drink today. The third one, without exception, our strong drinks of today were not even possible in biblical times. What do we know? It didn't happen until the medieval times that distillation was invented. It wasn't around in biblical times to make these strong liquors. So you can't compare the two. And when the Bible uses wine, it may be fermented. It may have been. But it also, just easily, could have been unfermented. Now, you can't prove which ones were which, but even when it was fermented, the alcohol content was so low, one biblical scholar said, your bladder would be affected far quicker than your mind to get to that point. Do you follow me? It's really quiet in here. John chapter 2. Listen to what Dr. Danny Akin says about John chapter 2. In his time, Jesus drank wine, and I'm sure I would have had I lived in the first century. However, there is no evidence that he partook of a strong drink. It is possible to become intoxicated from wine mixed with three parts water, but once drinking, here's that statement, would probably have affected the bladder long before it affected the mind. It should also be noted that children would drink this diluted mixture of water and wine, and it seems clear that there is no one-on-one correspondence with first century wine and 21st century distilled liquor. Concerning the latter, I believe the Lord Jesus would have no part. Now, there's all kinds of research you can do about this, and there's five different words for wine or strong drink, different words in the Bible. You can do all this, and I just don't have time. Obviously, you can tell it's 11:25, and I've got to start wrapping it up. A lot to be said about this, but bottom line is this. We're not talking about the same apples and oranges, okay? It's not the same. Let's talk about this quickly, this next one. The certainty in some and compromise in others. You go back and look 100 years ago, or even further back than that, there were two movements called the Temperance Movement and the Prohibitionist Movement. The Temperance Movement was in the 1800s. People like Charles, oh, I got to find his name. His name went up right in my head. What is your name, dude? Too many names up here to even find out where his name is. Where is he on here? Charles Spurgeon, there he is. I don't know how I forgot that name. He was not a teetotaler, but he became one in the Temperance Movement because of his two sons. But they were advocating you shouldn't drink, all right? You get into the Prohibition Movement in the 1920s and saying that we shouldn't do that. And all denominations, by the way, watch this now. All denominations, by the way, in this moment, Protestant that is, said that drinking was wrong and supported the Prohibition Movement. However, when it was abolished into the 30s, 40s, into the 50s, some of our denominations begin to slide away from us. The only ones that really stand with us on this idea, and by the way, Southern Baptists are, by the way, by teaching and by doctrine, we are considered a prohibition denomination. 2006 is our latest statement on alcohol, encouraging and calling for Southern Baptists to not drink. Okay, that's in our doctrine. But our Methodist, in particular our Presbyterian brothers, departed from us on this issue. Our Methodist and Presbyterian brothers have also departed with us on the issue of homosexuality. I'm just going to leave it at that. What once was right, or what was wrong, is now accepted as right. Does that make it right? And my heart's answer to you is no. Am I equating drinking alcohol with homosexuality? Absolutely not. Am I stating a principle? Yes. Just to note, by the way, people said that the prohibition time was one of the worst decisions in our nation's history. Listen to this statement by no other than a former U.S. Health and Welfare Secretary, Joseph Calafino, said this statement. Listen to this. This is shocking. During prohibition years, admission to mental health institutions for alcoholics, Pine Grove would be out of business. You ready for this? It dropped by 60% admissions during these years. Drunken arrests for drunken disorderly conduct went down 50%. Welfare agencies reported significant decline in cases due to alcohol-related family problems, and the death rate from impure alcohol, and there was a lot of behind-the-scenes alcohol in Alabama and Mississippi, we call it lovingly moonshine, but from impure alcohol did not rise. Nor did prohibition generate a crime wave, as some would love to believe. Homicide increased at a higher rate from 1900 to 1910 than during prohibition. And it didn't cause organized crime because organized crime was well established in major cities before prohibition ever came around. So what are the challenges considered? Very quickly. Y'all with me still? Y'all with me? I lost anybody yet? Y'all are with me? All right. Trying to blister through here. Two things to think about. Number one, we can cause others to stumble. My drinking alcohol could cause somebody else to stumble. And when people say to me, "Preacher, if you drank, it wouldn't cause me to stumble," I have to step back and say, why? It should. You would not want your preacher to drink. Why? Because the Bible condemns those who are in leadership to drink. It may cause someone to stumble, right? Romans 14, verse 13, what does it say? Therefore, let us not judge one another anymore, rather determine this, not to put an obstacle or a stumbling block in a brother's way. Verse 19. So then we pursue the things which make for peace and the building up of one another. Verse 21 closes it. It is good not to eat meat or to drink wine or do anything by which your brother stumbles. That's a strong statement, right? So most people go, okay, well, I get that, so I don't need to drink out in public. I'll drink in the privacy of my own home. Okay? Let's talk about this second thought. The carelessness of a double standard. Here's what you say to your children, okay? And I'm going to be honest with you. I do it too. I speed when I drive. And I say to my children, don't speed as I speed. How fast are you going, Daddy? Fast enough. Don't look. It's none of your business. Okay, so I'm calling guilty on me, okay, when I say this. So I'm not just going at you, going, you sinners, okay? I'm saying I'm the first and chief of sinners. Children do not understand this statement. They don't get it. You hear me? They don't get it. You don't do what I do. Do as I say. You hear me? They don't understand that you can do something, but they can't. And by the way, statistically, you know where most teenagers get the liquor, where they get drunk and drunk driving accidents happen? The highest majority, they got it from their mama and daddy's liquor cabinet. It's the truth. It is statistically borne out. The Kenner standard says, drink, but don't drive. My favorite thought about this is my favorite state of Louisiana. We have drive-through daiquiri shops. I just keep a lid on it and put it right here and don't drink it. Are you kidding me? Makes no sense. But that's the statement that is made. Vance Havner said this statement, I'm tired of hearing alcoholism called a disease. It's the only disease we're spending billions of dollars each year to spread. Adrian Rogers said this statement, what our generation does in moderation, the next generation will do in what? Excess. 20 years ago, survey was done of college students on Christian campuses. How many of you think that drinking alcohol is wrong? Over 90% said they agreed. They did a survey 20 years later in our day and age. 17% said it was wrong. What has changed? Has the standard and the principles of the Word of God changed? Listen to me, or have we changed? On this issue, and before we get all excited, some of us can aim in this one, and I can't because it's not a problem for me, but we can go and grab a few more over here if you need me to. Or I get over here and get all self-righteous and put my Pope hat on. It's a double standard. People say, well, I'll do it in the privacy of my own home. If you have kids, it's not private. I've spoken to a guy in years past, and he said, well, I have my own separate fridge, and my kids know that's Daddy's refrigerator. You don't go in Daddy's refrigerator in the garage. It's the privacy of your own home because your kids see you. Let me give an example in my home. I think I told you this, but I'm going to touch you again. My dad, I was in the sixth grade. Juarez Johnson, I remember his name, was my Sunday school teacher. Weird dude. God rest his soul, he's in heaven. Weird. You hear me? He was weird, all right? Sixth graders, we're like, this guy is weird. But we went to a Sunday school lesson one day, and he talked about alcohol, and it was wrong. It was in our Sunday school lesson. And my mom and dad, my mom had a bottle of wine in the summer. My mom might drink maybe a half a bottle over the whole summer. My dad would buy a six-pack. It would stay in the fridge all summer long. Right? I came home in the nice, bold manner that I usually do. And I stuck my finger in my daddy's face, and I said, Daddy, you got to get rid of that alcohol. It is wrong. My daddy got right here, and he said, Son, when I need your opinion on what I do and don't do, I'll let you know. Until then, you better shut your mouth. And it was not quietly in how he said that. It was a loud tone of voice. I shirked back going, I stepped in a pile of dog poo. I shouldn't have gone there. That was a mistake. I was 12 years old. My parents do not remember this, but I remember it like it was yesterday. Listen to me. I even asked my dad. We had a conversation when my dad was in the hospital about this very conversation before he died. Doesn't remember it still. I said, after that point in my refrigerator, listen to me carefully, I never, ever, once, to that day, my parents never, ever touched liquor ever again. Never. Never. They enjoyed it, liked it, loved to have a glass or two every year, but they made a determination, listen to me carefully, they would not make sure that their child was stumbling. So maybe some of us are going to have to make a sacrifice for the sake of our children, just like we are with our internet, just like we are with other decisions we make, for their good. And maybe not only for their good, for the good of somebody else. that's watching and listening and seeing things. Let's do these last things to think about. Our clear call and conviction. Here it is. I believe it's a principle issue. We can have a lot of debates about the wine, all those kind of things. But here's where I've always landed. It's a principle issue. Here it is. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Here they are. Look at these quickly. Scripture you're going to have to look at later because my time is completely gone. Number one, we are to be holy. 1 Peter, 1 Thessalonians we mentioned. Secondly, we are to be, the Bible says, you ready for this? Sober. Let me just give you one example quickly. This one right here. Pop that scripture if you will there. For you are all sons of light and sons of day. We are not of night nor of darkness. So then let us not sleep as others do, but let us be alert and what? Sober. For those who sleep, they're sleeping at night, and those who get drunk at night. But since we are of the day, let us be sober, having put on the breastplate of love, faith and love, and as a helmet, the hope of salvation. I am not real smart, but in this particular Greek word, this word literally means to abstain from alcohol, to be completely sober. That is a call for all of us, dear church. To be sober. And if I'm drinking, I can't be sober. Secondly, thirdly, we are to be the temple of the Holy Spirit. The scripture I was going to get to, 1 Corinthians. I know I haven't read much scripture to you, and I apologize. It's all right here. Time is short. 1 Corinthians says that we are to be the temple of the Holy Spirit. That means the Spirit of the living God lives in me. So I always ask this question to visualize it. Would you feel comfortable inviting Jesus to belly up? I know let's use these words. I don't mean this. You can't sit at a bar. Okay, hear me. And have a mixed drink with him. Would you have any issue with that? The temple of the Holy Spirit, that's what is our bodies. What do we take into it? And hear me, let's talk about, the one we love to often leave out of Southern Baptist. Let's talk about gluttony in a minute. Okay? Well, people love to get that one. Y'all Baptists talk about drinking, but you never talk about gluttony. I hear that a lot. Over imbibing in anything in the temple of the Holy Spirit, listen to me, is not of God. Are you with me? I'm not willing to not talk about one, but we talk about the other. Okay? They're both important. And those in between. We are to love the Lord with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Here's what we know scientifically. You take a drink of alcohol, you are killing brain cells. One of the reasons I chose not to drink is I really feel like I have a shortage of brain cells, and I don't want to kill any. But like I'm dumb enough as it is, I don't want to kill any more than what I've got. Here's what we know. When you drink alcohol, your brain changes. The chemistry of your brain changes. And if what that means to me is that when that chemistry changes, am I under the control of the Holy Spirit of God completely? Am I sober? Or am I under the control of something else? We are to be salt and to be light. Sometimes I think when our 50% of our culture are drinkers and we are being commended by our culture to do something, sometimes it's going to be difficult for us to be salt and light if we're going with the majority of our culture. It's going to be hard. I've heard people say, well, you know, preacher, listen, I love to go to places. I want to witness to people, even at parties. Teenagers, I heard this a lot. Listen, it's the truth. God is my witness. I could go to your next party on Friday or Saturday night, students, the people are drinking, and I promise you, I could win half your friends to Jesus, maybe more. I could. Because most people, when they get drunk, get real emotional and really willing. Okay? Here's the problem. They wake up tomorrow, they're not going to remember that they got saved. That's the truth. Well, I'm going to go and I'm going to be a witness and I'm going to have a clear cut with water. Well, here's the problem with that. Vodka looks like water. Why don't we set a different example and be over here rather than being like Lot and getting as close to the edge as we can without getting burned? Let's set a standard of holiness and purity and righteousness that a world says that's light and that's darkness. That's salt and that's not. The last one, we are to be different. Romans 12:1 reminds us, do not be conformed by the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds. Dear church, we are called to be different. Former President George W. Bush's wife, Laura, asked him, and you can read his account of a soul-scorching question. She asked him this question in the 80s, Can you remember the last day you didn't have a drink? He asked himself the question, could I continue to grow closer to the Almighty, or was alcohol becoming my God? John MacArthur, commentator, asked these questions. These are really, really good. I've added one or two in this list. But listen to what he says, just to think about this, in particular, this or any other issue, quite frankly, for that matter. Here are the questions to ask yourself. Number one, why do you drink and do you have to have it? Number two, is it necessary? Number three, is it the best choice? Number four, is it habit forming? Is it potentially destructive? Will it offend other Christians? And I would say weaker Christians in particular. Will it harm my Christian testimony? And is it right? I would tell you, even if Scripture did not condemn drinking alcohol, as your pastor, I want you to know I would condemn it. And let me tell you why. In 27 years of ministry, I have never, ever, ever gone to a funeral, and I've been to a lot in my life, where I ever saw a family member in an issue where alcohol was involved, look at me, and I've been to ones that have literally drunk themselves to death, something involved in traffic accidents. Never one of them said, boy, I tell you what, I wish we'd have been a little bit more relaxed about our drinking. Here's what I hear. I wish to God that I'd never been in my house. I'm going to tell you the day it came home to me in 1992 on a hot summer night in Waco, Texas. I was in a movie theater. I don't know who I was with, but we came out. I was a sophomore in college. Came out of this movie theater on busy Waco Drive. To compare, Waco Drive would be like Highway 98. Six-lane highway, no median in between. It was just all tight asphalt. And I came outside, and it was complete, this is at 10:20 at night, it was completely quiet. It was quiet. I'm like, what in the world? What's going on? You see flashing lights. I walk up to try to figure out what's going on, and this is what I saw. Seven people killed in a head-on collision. There was a car with five young people, ranging ages from, I think, 17 to 24, that had been at a party. They came down a hill on Waco Drive, driving well over 100 miles an hour. The driver's blood alcohol content was 0.17. Another person's alcohol content in the car was 0.23. Double, triple the legal limit. They came down, and there was a car pulling out of Mazzio's Pizza. A youth minister, which I was at the time, and three of his students. Hit that car head on. The car burst into flames. And I'm not exaggerating. There were literally bodies all over Waco Drive. I wish I could say it was the only time I've ever seen it. I pulled as a chaplain of a police department, as a volunteer firefighter, I've pulled people out of cars that were dead. I've pulled children out of a car where their parents were drunk and passed out and they couldn't get their kids out of the car. And I listened to them scream. Never once have I ever seen a representative of Coors Light or Bud Light, Budweiser, or Jack Daniels ever show up at any funeral. Never. Here was the problem about this story, though, that bothered me so very much. Put the next one, if you will. Alcohol called a fact in the crash. You can read a lot about there. Go to the next one, if you will. That was the next day. You can see a little bit closer up picture of the crash itself. And I don't want you to see this. It's shocking to see, but I want you to see it. Go to the next one. There's the funeral procession. The youth minister and two of his kids were killed instantly in that wreck. One survived in that car. In the other car, four of the five people in that car that were drunk died on the scene at that spot. The funerals followed over the next days. Here's what bothered me. Because people don't get it. Here's what the preacher said, and I never met Charles. I'd love to, because we would have some real terse words, I think. He preached over one of the boys that had been drunk in the car. He said this statement. This is a sad occasion, but we've got to face reality. And I quote, this is what God wanted. In this life, our life is like a rose, but it soon fades away and returns to dust. But we hope, as if I hope I'm going to win the lottery, we're going to a place where the rose will never fade. Folks, let me be crystal clear. That is not what God wanted that June 28th night in 1992. He didn't want it then, and he's not wanted it over the last 20 years plus. They interviewed one of the boys from the car. The boy that survived, his name was Robert Koenig. He says this, and I quote, "A friend tried to stop us. This is a month after the accident. It was just a bad mistake." Koenig said, "I would like to speak with the only survivor from the other car. I would like to apologize, though it was not my fault. It wasn't anyone's fault. Christopher was a great guy. He would never harm anyone intentionally. He wasn't a murderer like everyone is making him out to be. Everybody who got in that car did so by their own choice. It was just a bad mistake." Hear my heart, church. Most of us would say, "I'm never going to get drunk. I'm never going to drive and drink and drive." And I don't think many of you ever would. But my point is, why ever open the door? Oh, the heartache and the grief that I have experienced with people over this substance called alcohol. I pray you take time to look at these principles and these questions and evaluate and say, "God, would you speak to my heart on this issue? God, I want to be holy. I want to be pure. Not just in this issue on alcohol, but in the last week's issue of pornography and marriage and sex, and the week before of homosexuality, and we could talk about a host of other things. May we be people who are pure and whole." I know these are challenging words, but I pray to God that you hear them from a shepherd's heart that loves you and cares deeply for you enough to even address a controversial subject of which you might disagree. And listen, if you disagree with me, I'm still your pastor, and I will love you to the end. And I will serve you and care for you. You hear my heart? Are you with me? But I stand on this convictionally as a principle of the Word of God. Hopefully I'll have a job tomorrow. Just kidding. Would you pray with me this morning?